Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's Planning Commission hearing. I'm sorry about the late start. Today's date is April 28th, 2021, and the time is 9:37. Today's hearing is completely remote, and we are using a Zoom video conferencing meeting platform. For you at home who are viewing this hearing or who may wish to participate in this hearing, I wanted to take a moment to explain the technological pieces of the hearing. To participate in the hearing, you may connect with us via the Zoom link, which is posted on the Planning Department's homepage at sccoplanning.com. Alternatively, you may participate in today's meeting by phone. Please dial 1-669-900-6833. And when prompted, enter collaboration code number 885-1871-7533. If you wish to simply view today's meeting, it is being broadcast live on television as well. And for more information, please visit the community television website. A couple of instructions about participating in today's meeting. For each agendized public hearing item, time will be provided for speakers to contribute their testimony. Speakers will be muted until called on to speak. I will ask participants who wish to provide testimony to either remotely raise their hand by selecting the hand icon on their Zoom link, or if calling in by telephone, by remotely raising your hand by pressing *9 on your telephone. I will call on participants by either the name, by either your name or the last four digits on your telephone number. If you are participating via the Zoom link, when I call on you to speak, you'll see a pop-up on your screen that says unmute. Please accept the pop-up, state your name for the record, and provide your testimony. If calling in via telephone, you must unmute yourself by pressing *6 on your telephone. Members of the public will be provided 3 minutes to speak. If at any time you have difficulty connecting to today's meeting, please email me, Jocelyn Drake, that's jocelyn.drake@santacruzcounty.us. I will be checking my email periodically throughout the meeting, and I'm on standby and ready to assist you. All right, it appears we are situated, so I will now turn over the hearing to our chair, Judith Lazenby. Good morning, Judith.
Good morning, Ms. Drake, and good morning all, and welcome to this virtual April 28th, 2021 meeting of the Santa Cruz County Planning Commission. It is now 9:40. I will officially open the meeting. And could we have a roll call, please?
Yes. Commissioner Gordon?
Here.
Commissioner Shepherd?
Here.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Dan?
Here.
Commissioner Schaefer-Freitas?
Here.
And Chair Lazenby?
Here. At this point, are there any additions or corrections to the agenda?
No, there are not, Chair.
Thank you. And do any commissioners have any ex parte communications that they would like to declare? Hearing none. This is the part of the meeting when the planning commissioners welcome members of the public to speak on any of the issues of concern to them. But these issues cannot be those that are on today's agenda. You will have 2 minutes. Do we have any participants?
Yes, Chair, I see one hand raised. All right, I will call on this caller. There's no name associated or phone number with the caller, so I will just go ahead and unmute the caller. Good morning, please state your name for the record.
Oh, mute.
Good morning.
Good morning. This is Marilyn Garrett, and I'm bringing up an article that is related to what the Planning Commission will be having before them on 5G. This is from a publication WestonAprize.org. The article is titled The Contagion Fairy Tale by Thomas Cowan, MD, and Sally Fallon Morrell. Our book, The Contagion Myth, is now available, banned on Amazon, but sold on other outlets, and has already generated dozens of comments, many of them challenging our contention that the coronavirus, in quotes, does not exist, and that the illness attributed to this virus is not contagious. One comment even referred to our book as a fairy tale. Unlike most coronavirus skeptics, we are not arguing that the illness is just a bad case of the flu, with deaths due solely to pre-existing conditions or inappropriate hospital care. Rather, we postulate that the illness can be very serious and that the likely cause is radiation poisoning, probably from the worldwide deployment of 5G, starting in Wuhan, China, and followed by major cities throughout the world, end quote. And another quote states that 5G at 60 gigahertz stops the human body from absorbing oxygen. And we've heard a lot of hypoxia. So when you consider 5G, you must consider the implications and the consequences in a broad range of issues, toxic gas, et cetera. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else?
I am not seeing any additional hands raised, Chair.
Okay, thank you. So then we'll move on to the approval of the minutes of April 14th, 2021. Do I hear a motion?
I'll move the minutes.
A second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, they are approved as submitted. And we'll move on to item number six. Do we have Mr. Fort on the line?
Yes, we do. I will go ahead and promote him. All right, can we please pull up Mr. Fort's PowerPoint? Good morning, Mr. Fort. Can you hear us? Make sure you're unmuted on your side.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning.
So Will, as we're moving through your PowerPoint, just go ahead and say next slide when you'd like us to advance the slides.
Okay, great. Thank you. Good morning, commissioners. My name is Will Fort. I'm a park planner with the County Parks Department. And today I'm going to give some background information on the proposed updates to the park dedication fee program. And I also have, I believe, Debbie Kern from KMA and Kim Namba from the Parks Department here as well, who may be able to help answer questions if needed at the end. And to start, park dedication fees, sometimes referred to as Quimby fees or the related park impact fees, are different types of fees on new development that can provide funds to expand park facilities to meet the new demand created by that new development. So next slide, please. For your consideration in conducting the public hearing today, I'll go through three sections here. First, I'm going to give some background information on the underlying policies on our existing park dedication fee program. And then I'll go through the two different types of proposed actions that will be required to implement these updates. These actions include, first, ordinance amendments, these four chapters listed, and second, amendments to the unified fee schedule. Slide, please. So I will present the information related to the entire program update today. This has already been reviewed by the Parks and Recreation Commission on February 8th, and that commission has recommended the board take the associated actions. However, there are only some ordinance amendments that require review and recommendation by the Planning Commission. So these are the subject of today's hearing. These are local coastal program implementing sections of the county code. And these include these three chapters that are highlighted on this slide, 1501, 1505, which is a new chapter, and 1303050. So these will be the subject of today's hearing. However, I will go through all of the updates today, including those being reviewed by the Planning Commission, as well as the other updates. But today's hearing is only about the items to be reviewed by the Planning Commission. Slide, please. All of these associated actions will go under subsequent review by the Board of Supervisors through public hearings upon a recommendation from the Planning Commission. And after that, the three that are local coastal program implementing will require certification by the California Coastal Commission through a subsequent hearing. Slide, please. So I'll start with some background information. Next slide, please. The goals of the updates that we're talking about today are, one, to comply with current law, including the Quimby Act and the Mitigation Fee Act. Two, to align the county code with what is in the general plan. Three, increase social equity in how fees are applied. Four, to institute an incremental fee increase under a new fee structure. Five, to provide for the effective use of these limited funds. This is a small amount of funding for the overall parks budget. And so there's a limited amount of development in Santa Cruz County. We need to make sure that these funds can be used effectively. And number six is to incorporate fees for non-residential development as well. Next slide, please. So to understand these goals, here's some background information on the underlying policy. This is in the staff report as well. So California code includes the possibility of levying two different types of fees related to this program. First is the Quimby Act. Quimby fees are for residential subdivisions. They are fees that are in lieu of dedicating new parkland with that subdivision. The second is the Mitigation Fee Act. This allows fees or jurisdictions to apply fees to developers to pay to allow the jurisdiction to provide an expansion to the park system commensurate with that new development. These two types of fees have similar goals, but some differences in the requirements and how they are set up. Currently, county park dedication fees are codified in Chapter 1501. This includes a formula for the in-lieu fees, and these are mostly related to the Quimby Act. There is some room to improve the clarity between the Quimby Act and the Mitigation Fee Act fees, which we'll talk about later. And also, Santa Cruz County General Plan and Local Coastal Program includes underlying policies and objectives related to park service standards that are being implemented by Chapter 1501. And currently, the formulas in 1501 and the service standards in general plan are not consistent. Next slide, please. So here is a table summarizing the existing fees in the county, as well as for each of the four cities within the county for comparison only. And there's a column showing the fees for an estimated fee for an average size home. The fees depend on size, number of rooms, and in our case, location. The fees for the county are considerably lower than neighboring jurisdictions, and they have not been updated for over 20 years. So since fees are relative to the cost of acquiring new parkland and developing new park facilities, we can all appreciate the increased cost of acquiring land and construction in the last 20 years. So these fees are essentially lower now than they were 20 years ago when they were last updated when you account for inflation. Next slide, please. And currently the fees are also collected and held within a set of these 15 park dedication districts. These are shown in the black outlines on this map. There are also four independent park and recreation districts in the county. So there are actually 19 separate park dedication districts currently. Fees collected in a district currently must be spent in that district. This is not a requirement by the code or by the statute, but it is an administrative policy, and it has created through the unified fee schedule. Additionally, there are three fee zones, which are shown in these three green colors. These zones have differing fee rates currently based on, they're based on average land values when they were created, which was in the early 1980s. And fee zones are also not required by code, and they are created through the unified fee schedule. The goals of these districts and these zones were presumably to spend park funds close to where the fees were collected and to be equitable in the rates of these fees. However, in practice, both of these goals are inhibited by this practice. First, park districts are small and the balances of the funds stay small in a district. They're too small usually to fund a single park project. There may not be opportunities in that district. It limits the ability to spend these funds on the most impactful parks projects for the county park system. To address this, there have been loans from one district to another in the past, and this has created some unnecessary complications. Also, the fee zones with the different fee rates are not equitable in how the fees are applied. I'll just talk about this later as well. Next slide, please. So to look closer at how these districts are functioning, park staff completed a series of random park user surveys in the fall of 2018. And so this was a random survey of people in five different parks over two different days. Park users were asked if they lived, worked, or were staying in the same district as that park. And what we found is that more than two-thirds of park users surveyed did not. They didn't live in that district, work in that district, or were staying in that district. So this demonstrates that the districts are not an effective boundary for allocating the fees. And it demonstrates that the park system works as a network throughout the county. Park users use the parks throughout the county. Next slide, please. Here's a map showing median income from census data by block group in the blue colors and the outlines of the fee zones in the orange and brown. It's kind of hard to read. Next slide, please. This is a table summarizing that the data in that map. When you summarize these data, it's clear that areas with the lowest income are paying the highest park dedication fees generally. And this is an additional problem created by these fee zones that goes against the county's goals for increasing social equity. Next slide. And so that was a summary of some of the background current issues that we're trying to address in this program update. So now I'll go through the actual ordinance updates required to address these issues. So I'll discuss the four sections of county code that we will be amending. Three of those are local coastal program implementing ordinance that are part of the resolution recommended to the Planning Commission today, subject of today's hearing. Next slide, please. So I'll start with chapter 1501. Currently, 1501 has all of the policies related to Quimby fees, as well as trail and beach access dedication. So the proposed update that we're talking about today includes moving the trail and beach access policies to a different chapter. This will be the new chapter 1505. This will allow chapter 1501 to be solely about park dedication. There are also some other proposed revisions to this existing chapter. These include, first, separating and clarifying that these are related to in-lieu fees per the Quimby Act, as distinct from park impact fees, which will be part of and described in the new chapter 1503. Second, it'll establish park acreage standards that are consistent with the current general plan, and related to that, revise the methods for calculating the parkland dedication or in-lieu fees. Fourth, adjust the reporting and trust administration requirements, which are different from the Mitigation Fee Act. So make it clear how these funds are being administered. And lastly, other miscellaneous changes to the organization and wording of Chapter 1501. Next slide. The creation of Chapter 1503 is, again, not part of the local coastal program. So not part of today's hearing, but similar to the other impact fee sections, such as affordable housing and schools, say. So it is not part of your review today, but I'll just summarize this quickly. The new impact fee section will provide fees that are distinct and separate from the Quimby Act fees. It'll have new reporting and trust administration requirements related only to the Mitigation Fee Act requirements. Third, require regular Board of Supervisors to review and consideration of the adjustment of these fees. Fourth, allow the creation of fees for non-residential development. Fifth, change the fee structure from per bedroom to per square foot. This is a recommendation by the Housing Advisory Commission for all impact fees in the county. And lastly, it'll retain and actually expand some of the exemptions for affordable housing and for small ADUs. Next slide. So then portions of the existing chapter 1501 that are related to trail and beach access are recommended to be moved to a new chapter 1505. And there are also some other minor changes associated with that creation of a new chapter. One is to make some miscellaneous changes just to make it work as a standalone chapter and part of the LCP. Second, upon review by Coastal Commission staff, they have recommended changing the word beach to coastal access throughout. And third, they also have recommended changing the minimum public shoreline access easement where required of a width from 5 feet to 10 feet. And then lastly, section 130305 lists which chapters of county code our local coastal program implementing. So that will have to be amended as well to reference this new chapter 1505. Next slide. So that concludes the ordinance amendments that are being considered in today's hearing. I will also present a little more context by summarizing the unified fee schedule amendments quickly that will be going along with this overarching program to be considered by the board. Next slide, please. And these, for your reference, these unified fee schedule amendments will include one, separating and clarifying distinct fees for parkland dedication and lieu fees from park impact fees. Second, changing the fee structure for the impact fees from per bedroom to per square foot. Three, including recommended fee rates for the non-residential impact fees. And four, eliminating the three zones and the 15, or actually 19 districts, park dedication districts. And five, recommending incremental fee increase as compared to the existing fees. Next slide, I think this is the last one. There are also two accounting changes that would go along with this. One is to consolidate future fees and the current funds into one account and to clean up the park dedication fund loans between districts. And lastly, to review fees regularly in the future to account for inflation and increased land acquisition and construction costs. And next slide is the last one. That's the end of what I had to go over today, and we can take any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Fort. That was a very complete presentation. I will start with the commissioners. Do commissioners have any questions or comments?
I had a comment.
Commissioner Shepherd, go ahead.
I think these are well-crafted changes. It's hard to believe that these fees are lagging so badly. I'm on the board of one of a friend's organizations, and I would agree, especially since the pandemic started, we get more people from outside our district, way more. And I use other county parks all the time. So the kind of antiquated notion that the fees are specific to the district, assuming that we all only go to the park in our district, I think that needs updating. The fees need updating. I think there's well-crafted amendments. I support them.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I have some questions, if I could.
Commissioner Gordon.
Thank you. And thank you, Mr. Fort, for that presentation. This is a lot of information to put into a small presentation, so I appreciate it. And appreciate all the work that it takes to get there. So a couple of quick questions. Is the increase in fees solely to adjust for the change from us going from 3 acres per thousand to 5 acres per thousand? I mean, I understand that it's also because we haven't changed them in a long time. I get that, but is the change in acreage a major portion of this?
Is my mic still on here?
It is now.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. It is not actually. So the change in acreage is part of the formula that's used to in the study that's attached to the staff report. There's all the math that goes behind this. What that does is it creates a maximum justified fee, which would be the fee needed to really keep this level of standard according to all this math with new development. The fees that will be recommended to the board will be significantly lower than that maximum allowed fee, because to do that change at once would be it would be like seven times as much as the current fees, or that different amounts depending on each fee, but it would be a huge increase. So rather than doing a large increase like that, the board typically will set fees that are lower than the maximum allowed rate. So that will be what goes to the board.
So to clarify that we are at three, the general plan says 3 acres per 1,000 people, but we historically have more, 5 or more acres per 1,000 right now. And so we're trying to adjust to bring us up to where we're actually, what we're actually utilizing. But that in turn creates a higher fee, correct?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So to dig in a little bit more, we aren't creating housing, as you know, and so that means that our acres per 1,000 people is higher because we don't have the people. But if we had more people, then the acres per 1,000 would actually be a lower number. Is that correct?
If we weren't increasing the acreage of parkland, yeah, then yes.
Right. Okay, thank you. A couple other quick clarifying questions here. What is the proposed fee going to be? Or I'm a little confused as to what it's actually going to be. It said it'd be around 25% of the new assumed maximum total. Is that correct? But we don't know exactly what it's going to be at this time.
Yeah, so I didn't include the actual fees because this is not part of today's hearing. So that will be part of the unified fee schedule amendment hearing. I can read the fee rates. I can read the draft rates that we are currently anticipating recommending to the board. And those are for residential subdivisions that are zoned single family would be 4,200 per parcel, for multifamily 3,150. And then the new impact fees for residential projects that do not dedicate land or pay an in-lieu fee, there's a per square foot fee. Single family would be $2, multifamily $1.50. For residential projects that do dedicate parkland or pay an in-lieu fee, there's a per square foot fee of 23 cents for single family or 17 cents for multifamily. And for retail, so for non-residential, this is all by square foot. Retail, restaurant, and office would be $2 per square foot. Hotel, motel, and short-term rentals, $3. And industrial and R&D would be $1. And those are draft, they may change, and those will be set by the board.
But what you're saying is that today we are not considering whether or not those fees are right or should be right or anything like that.
Correct. So that's not part of the resolution or the actions before the commission today.
Got it. Okay. One last question here. In the report, it states that there's roughly $94 million worth of improvements needed solely based on new projects. And that's just like a hard number to swallow considering the amount of projects that actually happen here. So can you clarify, is that $94 million that you're ex- expecting to have to spend really based on new projects, or is it actually things that are existing problems that we need to fix? Does that make sense?
Right. That number is coming from the capital improvement program. And it's both. It is a list of mostly new park projects and new parks. But some of those are in existing, or includes renovations as well.
Thank you. That was all my questions. Thank you.
Can I just make one more comment? I forgot to mention.
Yes, Commissioner Shepherd.
I just want to say that I'm assuming that all of us in the community know how much more parks are getting. The more, as we try to get more infill and more ADUs and more people having adequate housing, moving in the direction that we all are interested in so far as possible, that means more park use. The park that I monitor, use has increased 200 or 300%. Henry Cowell's use is up by a very large percentage. It hasn't changed as things have opened up since the pandemic. So parks are really getting a lot of use. So I think putting the fees back where they, obviously this is 1998 is the last time fees were looked at. That's like 20 something years. And parks are really always strapped. They have hardly budget for anything. And this is, of course, in lieu fees. When we build housing projects, the builders, the contractors, or whoever is doing it has the option to provide the park fees, or they can pay the in lieu. This is an in lieu fee that they're paying so that we can establish and improve the park. So it sounds to me like it's well overdue, especially given the just intensive use of parks. We've never seen anything like it at our park. We've had to add additional parking, and it's amazing.
I have a question.
Yes.
Thank you. I just want to thank Will for your presentation. It was well laid out. The staff report was well laid out. I like the new format. I just wanted to ask a question about the general plan, the objective 7.3 that we provide, 2 to 3 acres of usable park acres per 1,000. And I think Tim was talking about this too. And you mentioned that we're more at like 5 acres per 1,000. But I wonder, because I know that in our district, most of the parks are in rural areas and not in densely populated areas. And so I wonder what that would look like, what that acre per 1,000 would look like if we just looked at the developed acres. the developed part of the county. Like, so if you just looked at like Live Oak, going down to Aptos, would that be different? And I'm kind of guessing that it would, because if you take out, Greyhound Rock and a lot of those rural parks, that it would show that actually in our dense areas, and especially in some of the lower income areas, that we have a need for parks. And kind of, jumping on what Commissioner Shepherd was saying, that, people are using them more. And so do you have thoughts on that, or was that analysis done?
Yeah, and Debbie, if you're there, if you want to raise your hand and chime in, if I get something wrong, you can correct me. But the study looked at the unincorporated county and just the county parks as a whole, and it did look at the usable park acreage. So that is somewhat accounted for. It's not including all the acreage of open space. It's more so it's according to neighborhood, community, and rural park classifications. And the usable acres. If you look more specifically at different parts of the county, particularly in Live Oak, and just look at county park acres per 1,000, it is much lower.
Existing. It is, okay.
And the state parks does have a web mapping system that they use for their grant program, and you can see how they calculate it there and you get a good sense of it that way.
Okay. Great, thank you.
Oh, Will, this is Debbie Kern. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry that my video is not working, but we did calculate what those averages are in the different areas. And so, and this, for community park acres per 1,000 urban residents, the existing service level is approximately 5.11 acres per 1,000 residents. And then for neighborhood parks per 1,000 urban residents, it's about 1.04 acres.
And that's throughout the entire unincorporated?
Yes, we don't have it broken down by each of the 19 areas. It's just the areas that were designated as urban versus rural.
So is that, can I extrapolate from that then that there is more of a need for the urban parks? Is that what that's telling us?
Well, what that is saying in the existing, when you look at the existing park acreage,
right,
that's the existing level of service.
Go ahead.
So it means that there are more, there's more acres, there's more park service in the urban areas than there is in the rural.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay, interesting. Huh. Okay. Did it account for situations like Pinto Lake Park, which is, you know, a gem of a county park? So that's probably heavily utilized by city residents as well, I would imagine. I mean, I'm a city resident and, you know, my husband's there almost every weekend playing disc golf. So did that factor into any of the analysis?
Well, I guess what is the designation of that park?
It's regional.
It's a regional. So we have...
Maybe, actually, it's probably regional, community, and neighborhood. I would have to confirm that. But okay. A lot of our parks have multiple classifications.
But I guess just in general, then the purpose of why we're here is I'm really glad this is being done. It sounds like it's been a long time in the works, and I really appreciate the analysis and the staff work and the Nexus study that had to be done to get us to this place. So I'll wrap up my comments.
Thank you.
We are interested in the beans, but
Commissioner Schaefer-Freitas. Are you on mute?
I'd like to wait until after public comments and then I'll make my own comment.
Okay.
Thank you.
So at this time, I will open the public hearing. And those of you who are online, you will have 3 minutes each person. So, Ms. Drake, can you open that up?
Yes. All right. So, I'm going to our list of callers, and I'm going to venture to guess that we have our previous caller on the line. So, I'm going to go ahead and unmute. Please state your name for the record one more time. Good morning.
This is Marilyn Garrett again, and thank you for clarifying questions, Commissioner Gordon. So I have questions too, and I'm joining you on a landline, so I'm not seeing any visuals here. If I were at the board meeting in person, of course I would, but are we talking about entrance fees? Are we talking about, before you answer my questions, I have some comments, additional property tax, which I pay a hefty amount of, and So I want that clarified, but I'm in this current economic state due to the destruction of small businesses during all this lockdown and the practical obliteration of the middle class. People are lacking funds, and parks are places that belong to the people, the commons, and people need to get out in the parks. And it's a basic right, I think, in democracy. And I think of this bumper sticker I had on my car for years. It'll be a great day when the schools have all the money they need and the Air Force has to have a bake sale to buy a bomber. That has to do with, you know, it'd be a great day when all our public services, parks, et cetera, are funded, and over about half our tax dollars don't go to the military. That's where they go now. So if you could answer, you know, my questions, I'm not wanting to increase taxes when people don't have it, and they don't have jobs. I've got retirement money, thankfully, still coming in from teaching. Okay, that's my comments and question. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Garrett. Mr. Ford.
Yeah, so thank you for the questions. So the first question about entrance fees, these are not park entrance fees. They have nothing to do with park entrance fees. There currently aren't, park entrance fees would have to be set through the unified fee schedule, but that's not what we're talking about today. It's not part of the resolution or anything that's going in here. And second, it's not a property tax either. These are development impact fees, right? So these are fees that would be paid at either at the time of subdivision or at the time of permitting a new development.
And what about the property tax?
It's not a property tax.
Thank you. Are there other members of the public online? I can't see.
I'm looking at our list of attendees, and I just wanted to remind everyone that is joining us today, if you wish to speak on this item, please press star 9 on your telephone or raise your hand on the Zoom link. Okay, Chair, I'm not seeing any additional members of the public who wish to speak on this item.
Okay, then that being said, I will close the public hearing, and then there will be no further participation by the members of the public. I'll bring this back to the commissioners.
Chair?
Yes.
I just want to commend staff on this report. It's so extensive and comprehensive, and especially the charts are easily readable so that things can be understood. I can only imagine how many hours were put into this by staff and by other county commissions too. So I want to thank staff for their report, and I'm prepared to approve it when the motion is made.
Other comments from the commissioners?
I echo Commissioner Schaefer Freitas, and I would move the staff recommendation.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to approve the staff recommendation and a second. Any discussion?
I'd like to chime in.
Yes, Commissioner Gordon.
I agree. I appreciate this is a lot of effort and work that goes into it, and I have probably a different stance, it sounds like, than most of my fellow commissioners. And if I could take 5 minutes to kind of talk about it, I'd appreciate it. You know, a little history on in lieu and impact fees. You know, they started in the Great Depression when taxes, people weren't paying their property taxes because everyone's losing their homes and things like this, right? And so no money was coming in to create roads that were needed for new developments and things like that. And so that's the impact fee. And over time, that's dramatically evolved into, into jurisdictions that in theory could use this for new public infrastructure that was a result of new housing. Like if you build a subdivision at the end of town, it needs roads, water lines, et cetera. And so either the developer paid for it or the city did. If the city paid for it, it was an in lieu fee to take care of it. Now we're at this point where developments are required to pay for the upgrades and the in lieu or impact fees. And so we're kind of, paying for two things. And it's kind of this result of a long gone broken, kind of a broken system of taxation, city and county funding sources that have tried to span the gap of the inefficiencies in our funding, especially as it relates to Prop 13 and things like that. So what we've done is create this gap or try to fill the gap with forcing new developments to pay fees to make up for the fact that we don't have the most efficient system of getting funding for cities and local jurisdictions, right? So what does that really do? That creates the cost of burden on the developer who, as you all know, can't officially pay for all, they can't pay to produce housing out of their own pocket. It's a business, right? So in reality, where does that fee go then? That fee goes to the new tenant or to the new homeowner. So what that means is that our housing prices go up when fees go up. That is clear. On multiple reports you can read, it goes up. And some say, every dollar in new fee is $1.50 in sales prices. So what does that in turn do? It creates two big problems, right? Historically, it can be used to limit growth. Super high fees mean less construction, doesn't get built, right? Then we have a problem where we're in right now, the county is in right now, where we have a high number, we're shooting for 3 acres per thousand and we're at 5 because we didn't build the housing. So we don't have the people, that would make that number lower. And so now we're raising our fees because we don't have the people. Then we are going to get less people. So then our fees will go up. So it's this circular reference that's this inherent problem, in my opinion. And what has that done in another way? It limits housing production, which has been historically a systematic form of racism and challenge in our community to be able to create housing that's affordable and more of it. And I won't get into all that right now, but I think it's a challenge that we need to be serious about. There are some things with this that I really appreciate. I think that affordable housing should not have to pay for impact fees. I think that's a great step in the right direction. I do think that it should be shared, not just by jurisdiction. I think that that is a good move. I agree with the fee going to square foot. That's going to happen. That should happen. That'll happen in any case, I assume, at the state level fairly soon. And changing the use of funds in certain zones. Yeah, as I mentioned, I think that's a big benefit there. But all that kind of said, I do have some concerns and some problems with this. I think that, as a park fee is really important for all of us, as everyone has said, and 100% agree, our parks over the last year have just been hammered, right? There's so many people out and about. People are really using them, and we need to make sure they're funded. I 100% agree with that. I think that this is one of many impact fees that are going to hit developments that, as some go up, others go up, and then all of a sudden our cost of housing is too great. And again, where does that go? It goes to the tenants, it goes to the homeowners, right? So we're just upping the cost of construction and essentially final sales price. I think another problem that I'm seeing here is that we're not currently accounting for the high values of construction costs at today's rate, right? And so construction is higher than it's ever been, not just because of, the general economy. It's COVID, fires, all kinds of things that would make it just exorbitantly expensive to build. And so while we're saying that we want to make sure we keep up with that from the park standpoint, we're also not considering that it's the most expensive time it's ever been to build comparatively right now. On top of that, we're going to start charging commercial clients and commercial buildings for park and lieu fees when we all know that commercial spaces are what we need to incentivize right now, because over the last year, so many businesses have shut down. And so in order to incentivize that, it doesn't feel like adding more fees is going to incentivize that commercial construction. And then I think, yeah, the biggest thing, as I've mentioned, is that, you know, what really happens with these in lieu fees is that the community ends up paying for it, whether they think they do or not. They want to put it on developers, but what does that mean? It goes to the new tenants, the new homeowners. So all that being said, long rant, I appreciate everyone listening. I personally can't support it as is. I would want to see some adjustments. I think that, you know, and I think that there's a few things here that I would need to see. First off, fees paid at occupancy. I think that it's a mistake to force developers to pay fees early before the actual impact is created. The problem with doing it at early on in the process is that the fees get paid and then it takes years to actually build the project. So while I appreciate that it can help the part, all the jurisdictions that charge fees, in reality, that is a refundable fee. So they can't really spend it unless they're going to put themselves, the county can't spend it unless they put themselves at risk, right? And so what are we doing? We're saying we have to charge more for developers early on so that we can hold their money, which fine, but then what happens in reality is that people don't want to build. So I think that putting the fee at the occupancy is critical. And I know that there are some adjustments in there that it's kind of close to that language at the director's discretion, but I would love to see that is fully implemented. And second thing, I think the term affordable, I really appreciate how that's getting updated to include affordable units. Let me rephrase that. We're not gonna charge more fees on affordable units. I appreciate that. I think that, as well as the small ADUs, I think that there's a couple things that we could adjust and benefit from there. Non-deed restricted units, as we learned through our RENA numbers, can count towards our RENA goals as long as they're affordable. So it'd be great if we could reduce or remove fees for affordable units that count towards our RENA goals as well. It would seem like those should match. And ideally, smaller units, if we're saying that ADUs count because they're 750 square feet or less, affordable by design, essentially. We have certain policies like the SRO policy that creates affordable by design units, right? Those should also be included in here, in my opinion. I would like to see, like, before I could be fully happy with this, this is a little side note, but I'd like to see a plan for how to create housing faster. The problem is that we're not creating it fast enough, so we don't get the money, but now we're going to charge more because we didn't get the money. So now we're still going to get no money. So 100% of this huge number, is still going to be zero if we're not producing the housing. So really we need to incentivize housing to go faster so that we can get more money to pay for parks. In reality, we don't get that money because we don't build the housing. I have a couple challenges with the study that was done. I think that the valuation based on of $1.4 million per acre based on recently sold properties is a little challenging to agree with, because the properties listed are all over the board as far as zoning, location, and all kinds of things. So essentially what we're saying is we're going to base our fee off of a $1.4 million per acre cost of land, when in reality we're talking about multifamily property that doesn't relate to actual cost of parkland. And that one I have a hard time kind of swallowing. Additionally, the use of looking at neighboring areas to compare prices is not always the best idea. We're a little safer in that here because, you know, one of the comparisons is the city, you know, but the county is a little bit different. You know, Scotts Valley is different. They're all different. So it's really hard to look at a study that's based on comparison because they're not all exactly the same. Couple of more things here. The actual increase, and I appreciate you stating those. That was really helpful. I think that needs to be very clear. A lot of studies, including those posted on HCD's website, state that if you're going to charge fees, it needs to be very clear, clearly updated, clearly outlined for everyone to see. And the reason for that is that transparency goes a long way with development. And when it's not transparent, people feel risk, right? And it's already a very risky thing to build housing, to build commercial space. So full transparency is something that I would like to promote. And then three more things here. Thanks for listening. Fees don't go down as the market goes down. I think that's a huge challenge. And when we look at the fees, you know, like I mentioned before, right now we're going to start charging a fee on commercial space at the absolute worst time, realistically, for commercial buildings, right? And so what we're going to do is get no money there because people are not going to build. And so updating those fees based on the current economic state goes both ways, right? Yes, let's update when it's time, but let's go back when it's not time. So I think it's probably an inappropriate time to add a fee to commercial space.